All right, so today we're going to talk a little bit about SmartSim. And today you'll hear from myself, Sam Partee, and Matt Ellis, and we both work at Hewlett Packard Enterprise. So a little bit about our team. We have three machine learning engineers, Alessandro Ragazzi, Matt Ellis, and myself, Sam Partee, as well as our director, Benjamin Robbins. As I mentioned, I'm a machine learning engineer for HPE. Previously, I worked for the Cray AI Innovation Lab before HPE acquired Cray in 2019, and I have a degree in computer science from Haverford College. Matt Ellis is also a machine learning engineer at HPE. Matt led our team effort around the Redis and RedisAI client architecture within SmartSim, and he has a PhD from MIT with a focus on HPC and computational physics. So what is SmartSim? Well, SmartSim is a library dedicated to accelerating the convergence of AI, analytics, and data science with numerical simulation models. If you're not familiar with simulations of high-performance computing or high-performance computing in general at this time, don't worry about it. Matt's going to touch on it a bit later, but for now, just think of them as large distributed computations that run on supercomputers or cluster systems and require large amounts of computational power. So traditionally, incorporating Python-esque data science libraries in these types of simulations is difficult, and that's due to many factors. Well, simulations are usually written in statically typed compiled languages that focus on speed, like C++ and Fortran. These jobs usually run, the simulations usually run as large batch jobs and can take hours, days, or even weeks to complete before they generate, before the data they generate can be accessed, analyzed, or otherwise used. So the data science ecosystem, on the other hand, is focused on iteration and speed of development and prototyping, and primarily use dynamically typed languages like Python for interfaces. So these two worlds are disparate and not connected as of today in some ways. Traditionally, simulations are run, and then their data is either analyzed offline after the simulation has been completed, and these simulations can take a very, very long time to run. So our goal is to bridge these two compute paradigms by enabling simulation models to talk directly with distributed in-memory storage provided by Redis. So utilizing the Redis ecosystem, SmartSim can connect models written in Fortran, C, and C++ to the modern data science stack online. So it's important that we note online here so that we're not touching the file system or waiting for the simulation to complete to perform any of the activities that I'm about to mention. So we have developed our four clients in C, C++, Fortran, and Python that implement the Redis AI API, and that are all cluster compatible with open source Redis. SmartSim provides these clients as well as methods for launching Redis and Redis AI onto high performance computing systems so that scientists can get their jobs up and running quickly and easily without having to be experts in how to launch this kind of infrastructure. In addition to the movement of data, simulations can execute pre-trained DL models and scripts stored within this Redis AI deployment adjacent to the simulation. Now, in this case, it's Torch script because that is supported by Redis AI. So you can store your data, store AI models, store scripts, and execute all of those from within your simulation. So lastly, to enable true interactivity, SmartSim users can utilize our Python client from within a Jupyter or IPython environment to analyze, train, or visualize their data in real time, being produced in real time by a C, C++, or Fortran simulation. So, with Redis AI plus SmartSim, we can interact with simulations at runtime through fast in-memory data storage. We can provide a DL library agnostic to some degree runtime callable from distributed HPC simulations at scale. So when I say library agnostic, Redis AI supports PyTorch, TensorFlow, TensorFlow Lite, and Onyx, which you can think of like scikit-learn models and Spark models and things like that. So instead of having to do things like compile TensorFlow or PyTorch C APIs into every single simulation, which is impractical and hard to maintain, you can call these libraries, use whatever you want in terms of a DL library to train your model, and then at simulation runtime, you can store these models within a Redis AI deployment and use the SmartSim clients to an architecture to launch that Redis deployment, as well as communicate with that Redis AI deployment without having to do any of that effort prior to do all the compilation of those C APIs. In addition, things like embedding Python interpreters inside these C Fortran, C++ simulations doesn't scale to the level that you need to run scientifically useful simulations, which is another reason why being able to call these deep learning libraries through an interface provided by Redis API and our SmartSim clients is so useful. So we can also, like I said, enable online inference training and analysis without using the file system. So traditionally, a lot of the approaches that have tried to merge these two worlds of machine learning and simulation have utilized a parallel file system as an intermediary. Well, one, this workflow where you use the file system has many stages, and it takes a lot of development to be able to do it in a reliable way. In addition, the data formats themselves aren't always conducive to machine learning. If your simulation is writing netcdf output or HDF5, sometimes those outputs aren't necessarily conducive to that fast data science iterative workflow that you find in that NumPy, Pandas, X-Array type world. So lastly, we can also write and prototype extensions in Python for C, C++, and Fortran-based codes that keep pace with these distributed simulations that are using, you know, C, Fortran, plus MPI, message passing interface, if you don't know what that is, and Matt will explain it in a little bit. But we can prototype these extensions in Python where it's quick and easy. You write a little bit of Torch script to do some filtering or some value augmentation for some piece of your simulation, and you can prototype those pieces very quickly, host them in this Redis AI deployment, and then call them from your simulation with just a few calls, as you will see. And I'll hand it off to talk a little bit more about it to Matt.
Thanks, Sam. So as Sam said, I'm going to talk a little bit about the architecture and API of SmartSim. So before we dive into the architecture and API, I want to give a little background on what we mean by a native parallel high-performance computing application. So HPC applications are normally a multi-process, multi-threaded application that run across many compute nodes, sharing information via one-to-one communication or large broadcast collectives. To put this in more concrete detail, in the lower left, I have a molecular dynamics simulation. The details of the simulation are not important for this talk, but what is important to understand is that a model like this usually will have too many degrees of freedom to fit on a single processor or even a single compute node. So what we normally have to do is split the domain up into smaller subdomains, and these subdomains will get broadcast and placed on processors across many compute nodes. On the right-hand side here, I have a depiction of what that might look like. This is the most simple layout where there's just MPI communication between each boundary of the subdomains, and these subdomains are just assigned to a single processor. This diagram, though, dramatically underestimates the scale of a problem like this. And just to give you a sense, molecular dynamics simulation can easily run on tens or hundreds of compute nodes. Furthermore, this is by far the simplest layout. Often there'll be a hybrid multi-threaded multi-process approach. But nonetheless, as we go further in the slides and talk about a high-performance computing application, this is a good stencil to have in mind. So now let's talk about the high-level architecture and library of SmartSim. So, as Sam said, the high-level goal of SmartSim is to combine these native parallel high-performance computing codes with your typical data science services. And to do this, there are really two primary functions of the SmartSim library. The first one is that it's actually quite hard to launch these native parallel high-performance computing codes alongside and at the same time as Redis AI with these services. So to solve this, SmartSim, actually part of it, is a layer that sits between the user and the cluster workload manager executor. This executor can be Kubernetes, Slurm, or PBS, and SmartSim presents a very simple Python API to the user that really makes it super easy to launch these two types of workloads. In addition to the layer that helps the user launch these workloads, there is a set of library clients that comes with SmartSim. These clients connect these native high parallel performance computing codes to the Redis AI servers over TCP. In addition to supporting the normal Redis AI capabilities, these clients also incorporate high performance computing, data movement, and storage strategies that are really focused at improving the performance of the applications that I just described. So I just want to give you a little bit more detail about what those special features are to increase performance of high performance computing applications. And so I'm just going to kind of go through at a high level some of the unique features of our client that accomplish that. First, it's worth noting that most scientific applications are actually written in C++, C, and Fortran, with data science ecosystems really in Python. So the first thing that we set out to do is we actually offer clients in C++, C, Fortran, and Python. And the really nice thing about this is we have a very coherent API across all of them. So work that is developed specifically for, say, a C application can easily transfer that knowledge to a C++ or Python application. And so scientists and engineers can really jump from one workflow to another. Another key feature of our Redis AI clients is we spend a lot of time optimizing them to provide advanced model and script distribution on a Redis cluster to maximize hardware utilization and throughput. And specifically what this means is that typically a Redis AI model set or script set would really just place a model or script on a single shard of the database. However, our clients automatically place a copy of the model on every shard of the database, which enables really large scale parallel inferences or evaluations of scripts. Sam will show the real power of this capability when he talks about our collaboration with NCAR. And finally, our client offers a data aggregation method through the dataset object. What this really allows users to do is group tensors and metadata into a single package that gets sent to the Redis database. And it allows users to interact with that group of tensors and metadata with a single key. So it's a real user-friendly feature, but it also allows us to do a lot of optimization on data transport. So with that said, I want to just give you kind of an overview of the client and dataset API. I hope you'll notice that they're actually very simple and straightforward. And what you won't see here, but what is true is that they're actually very coherent across all of the languages that we support. So the client API supports all of the tensor model and script operations that the Redis AI module provides. Again, the one notable exception is that client.setModel and client.setScript actually provide the ability to the users to really spawn these models or distribute them across the entire Redis cluster. This enables really large-scale inference sessions that are very low latency. The dataset API is similarly laid out of being built around sending and receiving data from the database. The functions for the dataset API are split into three main groups. First, building the dataset, second, storing and retrieving, and the third being trying to inspect the dataset, that is, pulling out a tensor or a metadata value. We support all of the Redis AI tensor types in the dataset, as well as floating point, integer, and strings for the metadata. It's just worth emphasizing that the user, what's nice about this is that the user can really add any combination of tensors and metadata, stage that locally, and send it to the database in a single transmission or object. So this really helps the user maintain kind of groupings of data and metadata that they like to manipulate with a single key. So with that, I'd like to pass it back to Sam to talk about our NCAR collaboration that leveraged both the SmartSim infrastructure library components and the clients that we've built.
Okay, hey, thanks, Matt. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about our NCAR collaboration. If you're not familiar with NCAR, they're the National Center of Atmospheric Research, and they do many different things, but one of those is work on the Modular Ocean Model 6, So I'm going to explain here our computational setup that we did for our collaboration with NCAR. The goal of the project was to improve the skill of a climate simulation with a machine learning model in an online fashion. So not using that file system as an intermediary. How can we do this online? Well, when we use SmartSim, we can do that. So the model we used here, as I mentioned, modular ocean model 6, production ocean model used in climate modeling. It's written in Fortran and it uses MPI. In this case, it was spread out on 3,551 cores. Each of those cores corresponding to one MPI rank, not using hyperthreads, and the Fortran variant of our SmartSim client that embodies the RedisAI API was embedded on each MPI rank, so each core. Redis in this case was distributed over 16 compute nodes, each with one 36 core Intel CPU and one NVIDIA P100 GPU, so 16 total GPUs. During the integration of the simulation uses this Fortran-based client in SmartSim to call the RedisAI PyTorch runtime to infer the value of eddy kinetic energy. So if you're not familiar with eddy kinetic energy, you don't really need to know at this time. It's only important to know that for high-resolution simulations that can take weeks to complete, this value, eddy kinetic energy is not fully resolved in the simulation. So not fully resolved, that means the simulation needs to be augmented with some system that's called a parameterization to approximate what that value may be. So traditionally, this is some system of equations. But here, we're replacing that system with a pre-trained deep convolutional regression model trained to predict that value of EKE. And it was trained before we hosted it in the RedisAI deployment on kind of ultra high 1/10th degree resolution simulations that are computationally impractical to run in current global climate models, but do resolve this very small scale value called eddy kinetic energy that even though it's at a small scale, ends up making a large impact on the output of the simulation. So if you didn't follow that, the too long didn't read on this one, is that we're augmenting a climate model with a deep learning model called EKE ResNet, utilizing the SmartSim clients and the Redis AI deployment you see there that we sometimes refer to as the orchestrator. So important takeaway here is that to augment the climate model with our approach in SmartSim, you only need the 9 lines of code that you see on this slide. And 4 of them at the top are done on an initialization, so they're actually amortized and the client connection times and all of that compared to the full runtime of the simulation is pretty negligible because the simulation in this case will run for multiple days depending on how many simulation days you run it for. But all of that upfront cost in those first 4 calls are amortized so that you don't see their impact on the simulation runtime. So you first initialize the client, create unique identifiers for each subdomain. As Matt talked about, these simulations are split over many domains. So to identify the data coming from each domain, we create unique identifiers for each piece of that domain. We load a script into the database for pre-processing and post-processing. And as well, we load that previously trained machine learning model, EKE ResNet, as I talked about, into the Redis AI deployment. So then every time step of the integration of the simulations, which is every 2 simulation hours, which depending on the resolution, in this case, depending on the resolution, it can take any number of seconds. But in this case, it'll take, it was roughly about 5 to 10 seconds per every 2 simulation hours. So every 5 or so seconds, it's doing all 5 of these calls. 3,551 times in parallel. It's doing that every 5 to 10 seconds. So the 5 calls you see there should be pretty obvious. It's an inference loop. You're putting some data, you're running a script for pre-processing on that data, you're running the model on the data you pre-processed, you're post-processing the output of that model, the inference of that model, and then you're retrieving that result. So in this case, it's important to note that the yellow highlighted ones, those calls, are the only ones that actually move data. And this is an important thing for us because through using Redis and Redis AI, we can make sure that the principle of locality is upheld so that we're never moving data when we don't have to. So in this case, also, it's important to note that unpack tensor is unpacking the inference value that's been post-processed into memory already owned by the Fortran simulation. So a little bit of results. So here we're showing the daily values for 1 year of eddy kinetic energy produced by our deep learning model, EKU ResNet, that was utilized to augment the MOB6 simulation online. So again, I'll note the presence of eddy kinetic energy, as you see here, would not be possible in a typical ocean simulation at this 1/4 degree resolution. This is only because of our approach that the model is able to capture these fields and produce a more realistic simulation. Because SmartSim can utilize non-co-located heterogeneous compute, you know, e.g. GPUs, with Redis and RedisAI, scientists now have the option to augment traditionally CPU-bound models with ML codes that run on GPUs and scale to where those they become scientifically useful. Because most of these models have to be written run at a very large scale. So, to show that the approach with SmartSim and Redis can scale to even larger models, we decided to stress test the architecture by adding 11 additional ocean models to the same Redis AI deployment. So each one of these is still basically the exact same as the previous computational setup, except for in this computational setup, they are each simulation is utilizing 910 cores spread over 19 compute nodes of Cray XC. So in this case, though, the database hasn't changed as per the last computational setup. So we increased the number of total clients communicating with the architecture, as well as kept the database layout the exact same. So still 16 GPUs over 16 compute nodes. And this ensemble was run for 10 years. So the ensemble of 12 simulations run for 10 years, where each year is around 7 hours of compute time. It's great that we saw negligible slowdown of the simulations compared to that previous state-of-the-art method. So it was around 6%, give or take, with a standard deviation of about 2%, despite adding 12 ensemble members to the same infrastructure. So even though they're running on a little bit less cores, fewer cores, they were not slowed down compared to the reference simulation that used the previous state-of-the-art parameterization. Which is that system of equations that I talked about replacing with our deep learning approach. Notably, the Redis AI and SmartSim clients, the Redis AI deployment and SmartSim clients handle nearly a trillion inferences throughout the simulations. And for our full 100-year simulations, they'll handle nearly 10 trillion inferences. So when I say inferences, that is number of grid points being augmented with a value of eddy kinetic energy. So they're performed in batches of about 400, and those batches are batched within Redis AI. So if you count each one of those samples in the batch as a inference, we did about 970 billion inferences throughout these simulations, with the full ones about 10 trillion. So in summary, with Redis AI and SmartSim, we can now enable flexible HPC workloads that are capable of taking advantage of the latest advances in machine learning, deep learning, and just generally the data science ecosystem that hasn't really been as accessible from the supercomputing or high-performance computing world. We're going to be providing these four Redis AI-enabled open source cluster-supported clients out into open source, as well as our SmartSim library. So we would really appreciate any contributors that are willing to help out with science and make some impact. And we've demonstrated the benefit of our approach, increased fidelity of simulation with negligible impact on runtime, and in general, just how this system can be used to better the workflows of scientists that are using modern high-performance computing systems. We hope that with this framework, together with the Redis community, we can kind of help move science. We can help move science forward faster. Thank you. And if you want to check us out on GitHub, the link is right there. In addition, if you have any questions or if you're looking for any more information on the experiments that we did or future papers that we're going to be writing, please let us know. Our emails are right there, and we're happy to talk to just about anybody. Please reach out. We'd love to hear from you. Thank you.